My diagnosis, I come here to the Cleveland Clinic. They had a clinical trial where they were sending tissue out to be tested with Foundation One, I believe. And Dr. Pinnell told me about that trial, got me into it, and sent my tissue off. Because I had been tested for all the other ones, right? And every time I'd get the phone call and be like, nope, you don't have that one. Nope, you don't have that one. So I'd sort of given up. I thought I didn't have KRAS. We didn't know what I had, but we knew that it was nothing that had ever really come up yet. So when I got that back and it was red, at the time, we didn't really have much to do about it, but like I felt really hopeful because at least I had something. And in some sort of weird way, it made me feel better to know that that's what had happened. I just have a mutation. That's what happened to me. I didn't do anything to cause this. You know, I didn't put myself in a situation that made me have lung cancer. I have this genetic mutation. So I have actually not had any targeted therapy yet. This will be the first one because the ones that were sort of available were really more toxic than what I was taking. So I was on Alimta for a very long time. That was fine, and I tolerated it pretty well, but I didn't want to take anything that was more toxic than that.
So what is the drug you're going on to?
It's called the Loxo trial. So we'll see. We'll see what happens. I think it's going to be great. I feel very hopeful.
And
we will talk about that. Yep. Okay. So I'm going to introduce you guys, and then I'll let you. Who wants to go first?
I think mine are put up after yours.
All right. So Dr. Karen Redkamp is a physician at the City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in California. She is an associate professor in the Department of Medical Oncology and Therapeutic Research at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center. She received her medical degree from the University of Chicago and her master's degree in clinical investigation from UCLA. She completed residency training in internal medicine at Barnes Jewish Hospital and a hematology oncology fellowship at the David Geffen School of Medicine at UCLA. So she lives in sunny California where the weather's perfect all the time. She's a member of many thoracic committees and has won several awards for her research efforts. So take it away.
Thank you. So I'll be talking specifically about BRAF mutations in lung cancer. So BRAF was first described in melanoma, and the drugs that we use now were approved in melanoma and showed spectacular responses in a disease that had very few options at the time when people were being treated for melanoma. Just this year, just a few months ago, dabrafenib and trametinib were approved for BRAF, non-small cell, V600E non-small cell lung cancer. And so now we have a FDA-approved option for patients with BRAF mutations with lung cancer. BRAF is something that if you don't test for it, you won't find it. And so I think that's something that is a underlying theme of this session, because there's still variability in what people test for. I often see patients who have a panel of mutations that were tested for. Sometimes it includes BRAF, sometimes it doesn't. It most often does not include RET or MET. And so it becomes very important if you have something that is very targetable and treatable to test for it. And I'll tell you a patient story that exemplifies that and has a similar story to Sarah, where this wasn't known until far into the diagnosis. So BRAF mutations can be found in multiple tumor types. They are uncommon, mostly common in melanoma and colon cancer, but less common in other tumor types. In lung cancer, it's about 1-2% of lung cancers. There are multiple types of BRAF mutations that can be found in lung cancer. V600E is still the most common, but there are others that have varying responses to these inhibitors, not necessarily as good as the V600E mutations. So this is showing prior therapy treatment with a V600E B reputation in non-small cell lung cancer and treated with either vemurafenib or dabrafenib therapy. On the left, we see patients treated with vemurafenib and excellent responses on PET scan. As you can see, on the left is the prior to therapy, on the right is after therapy, and the PET active disease is essentially gone. And then on the far right, you see multiple CT scans from a patient treated with dabrafenib therapy with the V600E mutation, and again, the pre-study at 6 weeks and at 4 months, and the tumor significantly decreased. So this is really what we see with targeted therapy. So again, when we have a targeted therapy, this is what we call a waterfall plot. We've seen these already several times today. And again, each line represents a patient, and when they go below the middle zero line, that means the tumor has shrunk, and the farther they go below, the more percentage shrinkage the tumor has had. When they go above the line, it means the tumor has grown, and the longer they are above the line, the more the tumor has grown. As you can see with this, most patients had some tumor shrinkage with vemurafenib with V600E mutations for non-small cell lung cancer. This is in a small subset of patients, but this is really what we see when we have a gene target and a drug that hits that target and causes tumor regression. This is the study with dabrafenib alone. And again, we saw there were significant responses, about 33%. And then this study was expanded to look at both dabrafenib and trametinib, which has been shown to be an improvement in melanoma. And so the combination here, again, significantly more responses, to up to 63% with the combination, and some of them long-lived. So these drugs work incredibly well for BRAF mutant non-small cell lung cancer. And again, here's an example of a patient treated with dabrafenib, and again, significant tumor shrinkage, and this was something that was prolonged, and that was with dabrafenib alone. So let me just tell you, so the patient that I want to talk about is a woman who was in her late 40s, diagnosed with non-small cell lung cancer about 8 or 9 years ago now. And we tested at that time for EGFR, was really one of the only things to test for and treat at that time, and EGFR was negative. She got chemotherapy, which was very helpful on a clinical trial, and had a great response to chemotherapy, and then within 15 months progressed and went on second line therapy. At that time, again, this was a minimally smoking, relatively young person, and so erlotinib was a drug of choice as second line therapy at the time. She went on Tarceva and progressed straight through it. And we had a conversation about end of life, what that meant, and what we were going to do next. So she was on a trial that didn't give her first-line therapy with Alimta, and so she went on to Alimta and actually had about a 2-year response to Alimta. And at the end of that, went on to our standard Taxotere and had a lot of toxicity but had tumor response. So her tumor responded to a lot of different things. And in that time, she was tested for ALK, she was tested for ROS1, none of them were positive. So we were at a point where she was on Taxotere and feeling poorly because of the toxicity, but responding. And really, the quality of life was not there. There was a lot of depression and a lot of question of whether this was worth it at all. So we had a conversation about retesting. She had she actually had a breast mass that we could biopsy and was part of her lung cancer, subcutaneous metastasis. So we biopsied and sent off for a large panel, and this was probably around 2012 or 2013, so about 5 years into her disease. And so this was clearly a lung cancer that was not your standard lung cancer anyway, but we biopsied this, we sent it off, and BRAF V600E came back. Mm-hmm. At that time, it was established that vemurafenib and dabrafenib were approved for melanoma. We tried vemurafenib, and she had to discontinue due to some of the skin toxicities. She got dabrafenib and had a near-complete response for about 2 years. The follow-up on that story is that following that, she developed tumor in a different area, more in the spine and lymph nodes, And also, we had another conversation about end of life, and this was a very serious thing. And we tried, but this was prior to immunotherapy being approved. We tried to put her on a trial with immunotherapy, and then immunotherapy became approved for lung cancer kind of as she was going through this trial. And she went on nivolumab and had another near complete response. So she has a remarkable tumor. But I think the important thing is, and it's always been BRAF V600E every time we tested it without any specific resistant mutations that we could find. But the important thing is that if you don't test for it, you don't know that it's there, and you don't get life-saving treatments. She would have never got the immunotherapy had she not got the BRAF therapy. She would have never got the BRAF therapy had we never thought about testing again. Mm-hmm. So being negative and then living a certain amount of time, testing again makes sense because we learn about new mutations that may have not have been tested the first time around. And we'll get more from Bansi with the RET and MET. MET is one that was not tested up until recently, and if you have a panel, MET may have not been a part of that testing. So it is incredibly, I think we can't emphasize enough that you need to test, and sometimes you need to test at multiple times temporarily if you're looking for a specific mutation. And then when resistance happens, as we talked earlier, with tumor heterogeneity and what can happen with resistance, you need to look again. And now with liquid biopsies, that's a little more safe and accessible. So again, BRAF V600E, is an actual mutation in lung cancer. The interesting thing is that, so we always tested our young non-smokers. And that was kind of like, okay, we'll send for more testing. But BRAF actually happens more commonly in people who are prior smoking. And so now excluding anybody seems not like the right thing to do. And so testing everybody, especially with adenocarcinoma, who should be tested with broad panels. And dabrafenib-trametinib is now the first drug combination to have FDA approval for lung cancer with a BRAF V600E. And there's meaningful anti-tumor activity with the combination and with each drug separately. And the safety profile is very generally similar to what they see with melanoma, manageable. Skin toxicities, hand-foot syndrome, things like that, but tolerable and manageable. And then finally, we wanted to include the clinical trials available. At this time, I could find 4 BRAF trials that are actively accruing. There's a combination trial with a pan-RAF inhibitor and an ERK inhibitor. That's a phase 1. There is a trial that has multiple arms, and regorafenib is the arm for BRAF, and another one that with multiple arms for selumetinib is a MEK inhibitor, so it is for BRAF and KRAS, and then the NCI MASH trial, which is still using dabrafenib for the BRAF patients. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Now we have Dr. Belcetti.
Questions?
They've been wanting us to do the whole thing, and then we do like this whole open panel.
So Dr. Belcetti is the staff physician of medicine at the Cleveland Clinic Lerner College of Medicine, staff physician in the Department of Hematology and Oncology at Cleveland Clinic Cancer Institute. His specialty areas include lung cancer, mesothelioma, and thymic tumors, and the use of novel immunotherapies for the treatment of lung cancer. His translational research focuses on identifying patients with molecular changes in the tumor that can predict response to immunotherapy and expanding clinical trials, focusing on immunotherapy and novel agents. Thank you for being here. Thank you for having this trial that I'm going to get on.
RET fusions in lung cancer are a relatively rare event. As Dr. Rickamp has said, our understanding of the biology of lung cancer has been evolving over the past decade, and for a lot of patients who had previous testing for EGFR, ALK, and a few other genes, this landscape is constantly evolving, and we are finding new targets that could potentially have clinical relevance in patients who have lung cancer. So that's it's very important to have a broader panel of genes to test in patients who are diagnosed with lung cancer. So RET fusions are seen in about 1% or less of all lung adenocarcinomas, and RET fusions are more common, and RET alterations are more common in some tumors like thyroid malignancies. And there are various types of RET alterations that can happen. You can have mutations in the RET gene. You could have amplification of the RET gene, and you could have increased expression of the protein in the RET gene. And there are some oncogenic fusions where, like, the RET gene is transferred to a different area of the genome, and the RET gene is thus constitutively activated. And in lung cancer, RET fusions have been reported to be of a lot of clinical relevance, and they're oncogenic in nature and a driver of mutations that could potentially be targeted with targeted therapy. So the early reports of clinical activity of some drugs that have like a RET kinase activity were reported back in 2013 and 2014. And these drugs were not specifically designed to be RET inhibitors. These are drugs that are already in the market, or some of them were in clinical trials looking at various other kinase activity in solid tumors, but they happen to have some degree of RET inhibitory activity. So there were several clinical trials for these agents, namely cabozantinib, which is a drug that is FDA approved for use in thyroid cancer. That's a drug that has like inhibits a lot of different kinases, including RET, but it has a lot of activity against VEGF and FGFR, and so does vendatinib and lenvatinib. These are all drugs that have like multi-kinase activity. And as you can see here, there were several small trials that were done with these agents. And as you can imagine, like doing a trial with a rare mutation is fairly challenging, and you know, oftentimes it's really hard to find patients for these trials. And patients are very distributed geographically, and when you have a rare event, it's often hard to do large trials. And based on these early clinical trials, single-arm trials, small trials, the activity of these multi-kinase inhibitors, which are not specific for RET, the response rates are somewhat modest. And one of the main reasons for that being to achieve a therapeutically significant doses of these drugs is very challenging. What I mean by that is, like, at the doses that inhibit RET at a clinically meaningful level, you have other side effects, like when you have drugs that inhibit VEGF and other important pathways, it is quite challenging, and these drugs are very toxic at the doses that would be appropriate for somebody who has a RET fusion. So what has happened over the last couple of years is there have been a lot of new drugs, advances in drug designing that led to development of some novel new small drugs which target the RET kinase, which are highly potent, highly specific, and they don't have the same degree of inhibition of other kinases. So there are two drugs specifically, LOXO-292 and BLU-667. These are highly potent small molecule inhibitors that actually are very specific to RET, and they have very minimal activity against VEGF and other tyrosine kinases. So what that allows us to do is to have a drug or therapeutic that actually inhibits the kinase that is of relevance for that particular patient, the RET fusion positive patient, without interfering with other kinases and avoid toxicity. And right now there are several trials, clinical trials ongoing with RET inhibitors in patients who have RET fusions. There's some trials with alectinib, which is an ALK inhibitor, which is already FDA approved for ALK. Cabozantinib, the trial currently ongoing, ponatinib and vendetinib. But like I said before, all these drugs are non-specific, or they have like multiple kinase activity and have like a lot of toxicities, and the responses, as I showed earlier, were somewhat modest. So the two trials that I'm most excited about are the drugs that are highly potent and highly specific RET inhibitors, LOXO-292 and BLU-667. And still very early in development, and you know, we'll be seeing the data soon. I have the pleasure of actually presenting this data, the first clinical trial data with LOXO-292. We'll be presenting this data in Japan next month, and you know, I'm hoping that we'll be able to enroll quickly to this trial and develop new therapeutic strategies for RET-positive patients. So with that, I'm going to move on to the next session on MET. So MET is a very interesting target. It's actually altered in about 4% of all lung cancers based on the TCGA data. And MET is a very clinically significant target in lung cancer. And it is actually overexpressed in nearly one-third to nearly half of patients have some degree of RET overexpression. However, MET expression, or that is like MET protein levels, haven't panned out to be very predictive for predicting response to MET targeted therapy. There were several drugs that were studied in this context, especially crizotinib. In fact, crizotinib, which was all of us know, crizotinib as like a very good ALK inhibitor and FDA approved for use in ALK mutant patients. But however, crizotinib was first developed as a MET inhibitor, and it was actually being studied in patients who had like MET alterations. Mainly MET expression, and there were other drugs like antibodies targeting MET, METMAB, that were evaluated in large clinical trials looking at benefit in patients who had like MET expression. The problem with MET expression is having a biomarker that could identify patients, and defining the cutoff of level of expression of the protein has been a challenge, and the trials were all negative, and so there are no drugs currently approved for use in patients who have MET expression, that is MET protein expression. However, there are other genomic alterations that could happen in MET gene, like amplification, and there are sometimes you can have like MET mutations, and these are mutations in the kinase domain that make the MET gene constitutively active and increase the signaling downstream because of this mutation in exon 14. So when you have that exon 14 mutation, there are several reports in 2015, and there was also a clinical trial that was actually presented by Dr. Drilland last year, looking at patients who had a MET exon 14 mutation, and using crizotinib, they were like very good responses. And this is a waterfall plot from the trial that Dr. Drilland had done. It's a very small trial, just a handful of patients, but however, this is a similar kind of waterfall plots that we're used to seeing with patients who have oncogenic alterations like EGFR ALK. As you could see here, majority of the patients had like some tumor shrinkage, but it's a small trial. There are more, we need more trials and more patients to confirm that this drug is really active. But based on what we see so far, crizotinib seems to be an active agent in this rare small subset of patients with MET exon 14 alterations. There are several trials currently ongoing. There are like newer generation specific MET inhibitors like tepotinib and meritizumab. There's also this NCI MATCH trial that Dr. Rikant had talked about. There's also a MET exon 14 and MET amplification, which is allowed to participate in that trial. In that arm, the drug for MET is crizotinib. So there are some opportunities for patients to participate in these trials. We really need patients to participate in the trials whenever it's possible. Of course, you know, when patients can't get access to clinical trials and they have a MET exon 14 or any rare alteration for that matter, I think using some of these drugs which are already FDA approved makes reasonable sense. But however, if there's any access to having ability to participate in a clinical trial, that would be strongly encouraged and recommended. Thank you.
Thank you. So do either of you have any questions at all?
You can do it online.
Okay. So there's one question. So I'm not sure it's specific to RET or MET, but
it is.
Okay. So it's sort of long. So she was diagnosed in April 2017 was stage 4 adenocarcinoma in both lungs with no brain or liver. She got Foundation Medicine 1 genetic testing, which showed a CDKN2A mutation. Okay. Splice site 151-2AG. So her question is, do you recommend that my oncologist consider treating me with a CDK4/6 inhibitor, either in a trial or an inhibitor such as palbociclib?
Palbociclib.
Thank you. Or under under compassionate use. Does that make sense? Would you like? Okay.
But so CDK and 2 loss are, happens pretty frequently in many cancers and can be a co-mutation. I don't know that there's a lot of evidence that it's a true activating mutation at this time, and so outside of a clinical trial, I would not specifically use a CDK4/6 inhibitor, potentially through a clinical trial if it allowed the alteration, but outside of a clinical trial, I wouldn't recommend it, and I don't know that we are confident that it really is an activating mutation. And so mutations occur, and now that we can get these large panels, there are mutations such as BRAF, MET exon 14, ALK, EGFR, that are true activating mutations, and when you have a drug and a target, it blocks it and causes significant tumor shrinkage. And then there are lots of mutations that occur that don't have that true, you block it, it causes that. And KRAS is another one where there isn't a direct effect necessarily. Interestingly enough, there is some activity of CDK4/6 inhibitors in KRAS mutations. And so outside of a clinical trial, I wouldn't do it, potentially within a clinical trial.
I completely agree with that. And to add to that, one of the challenges with comprehensive genomic profiling, we like it and we hate it. The problem is, like, a lot of times we have information that we actually don't know what to do with. Like, for example, patients, especially in lung cancer, and Karen, this is a question for you, in lung cancer, there are like a higher rates of non-V600E BRAF mutations compared to like melanoma. I mean, that's been a challenge in my practice, actually. The data so far has been pretty disappointing in terms of response to BRAF targeted therapy, and especially the non-V600E. We don't have enough data with a combined MEK BRAF mutation in non-V600E, but however, at least single agent responses have been really.
So BRAF inhibitors don't generally work in the
non-V600E.
Trametinib and MEK inhibitors, there's been some reports. If you are on the NCI-MATCH trial, I think trametinib is the arm for those patients. There was a trial with RxDX-105 that had some responses in that cohort, but I don't know that they had enough to really move that forward. So the non-V600E are definitely different mutations. And so that's important to know. The one thing I would also say that this patient, if their testing was in 2014, there's a question whether MET was in that panel or not. Mm-hmm. It's kind of, so finding out whether MET was tested, they often, Foundation can often go back and do it if it wasn't done, and so that's something they can go back and look at.
Okay. And that's a challenge with a lot of other alterations. We find all these mutations that we just don't have enough information, and sometimes they're such rare events that how to make clinical decisions in terms of treatment. Generally speaking, the rule of thumb is if they have a rare alteration that we're not confident it's an active or actionable alteration, we strongly recommend standard treatment prior to actually trying anything off-label.
And most of these activating mutations happen within the tyrosine kinase domain, and even the skip mutation is around the tyrosine kinase domain in MET. And so if it is in or around the tyrosine kinase domain, is more likely, because we think about this too when we see some of the rare ALK or the rare EGFR, and it's within that tyrosine kinase domain, that's a suggestion that you will have activity. And so that would be something to look for, because there's often preclinical data about these mutations, even when there's not clinical data about the mutations.
So if you have KRAS, are you excluded from having BRAF, MET, RET, all those, is that to the exclusion of?
So not always, okay. But sometimes. So KRAS generally is the main mutation mm-hmm. that a tumor has, but we've seen co-mutations. They're relatively less than 1%. Not unheard of, but KRAS is generally the dominant mutation that we see.
Okay.
But again, as you get more and more treatment, that can change too. And so sometimes reassessing after multiple lines of treatment is also helpful.
Mm-hmm. And then the determination after KRAS of G12D means anything or nothing, or we don't know.
It's where the KRAS is found, and some of the KRAS mutations are a little different. There's a lot of heterogeneity within the KRAS mutations, which is why there's not one drug that just works at all of them. And sometimes the co-mutations are also important for KRAS. And so there's a lot of subtleties to KRAS. But there are trials that are up and coming for KRAS, so that's something that's not something that we put in here, which yeah, probably should for future years. But there's definitely a lot of work, because KRAS is the majority of non-small cell lung cancers. Mm-hmm. It's the highest percentage, about 25% of adenocarcinomas have KRAS. And so it is a majority, but still it's a little bit of an enigma for us to treat.
But in terms of preclinical data, I think we are making some progress in understanding those subsets of KRAS mutations, mm-hmm. especially if you have a certain kind of co-occurring mutations, they might lend itself to certain therapeutic
CT, there's like a lot of C's,
Sibyl.
43, and no, am I on the wrong track? Okay. I don't have it written down, so I don't trust myself.
KBV, and it's still very preclinical.
Okay.
Like, I don't believe there are any trials yet, but very soon they will be.
Mm-hmm. And then the combination, so if you've got your testing with Guardant for the liquid biopsy, because that's where most of this came from, because then they tested the tumors for ALK, RAS1, all those other ones that were negative. I know you might not know something that was in there, but the other ones that were in there were TP53, the CDK, N2H you mentioned, KRAS, NF1, and MYC. That combination?
Very common, and can be co-mutations, may not be specifically targetable. NF1 is also one of the arms in the MATCH trial that I think actually just closed. But again, going with testing through Foundation, you can actually get into the MATCH trial now.
Okay.
And so that's another way, because the MATCH trial at least provides targeted therapies for some of these rarer mutations. And that's constantly changing. They're constantly adding arms. So having tumor tissue sent through Foundation does help you potentially get into that trial.
So we have another question. Does BRAF V600E have a resistant mutation like EGFR has?
So at this point, I don't know the data for melanoma, but I think there are some resistance mutations that occur, and I would expect them to be similar to what happens with melanoma. It's such a small cohort, and we haven't actually been, I think, number one, people haven't been tested all that frequently, so we don't see it. And we've just started being able to broadly give the therapy to patients. And so that's still left to be determined.
Okay. Follow-up question is, what kind of response have you had in your patients with TAP/MEK for BRAF V600E?
So it's an excellent response. I mean, the most comprehensive data comes from the phase 2 trial, and they had about a 60% response rate, so that means 60% of people had tumor shrinking at least 30% or more. As you see, some of them had durable responses. My N-of-1 on dabrafenib alone had a 2-year response, and so we see excellent responses in patients with V600E treated with the combination therapy.
And we published our experience here at the Cleveland Clinic with dual BRAF inhibition, and we see durable responses somewhat better than
more frequently than melanoma. And melanoma, right, they don't see as long responses. We seem to have longer responses.
So I wonder if you guys could talk a little bit about if I, as a patient, go to clinicaltrials.gov, and I look up my mutation and I see that there are, let's say there are three trials that it looks like I would qualify for, how do patients go about figuring out which one is the best for them?
It's often a challenge, and a lot of times, you know, you should remember, like, some of these early trials, we don't have much public information to really go by. And the best option really is to speak to your treating physician to see if they know about the trial or if they have any insights into what drug this is. Like, for example, some of the RET trials, some of the newer agents, none of the data is actually published. And trying to have insight into what the trial is, what drug, what kind of drug it is very important.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking to the treating physician would be the first step.
And I think that on top of that, so it's great that we have clinicaltrials.gov and patients can look this up, but understand that there's a lot of complexity. So when you have the eligibility, they're giving you a summary of some of the eligibility, and everything has to be perfect in order to get on that trial. And so if your treating oncologist knows nothing about that trial and really says, I've never heard of the drug, I know nothing about it, I know what you know of what you printed out on that sheet, then there's always contacts on there. And whether it's a company or an institution, there should be somebody answering that call that can tell you, is there something close to me? Can I speak to somebody who, you know, either the coordinator or the physician who's running the study? And then you can get, when you connect with the trial specifically, you can get more specifics about whether you really would be eligible. You know, because sometimes there's a limited amount of prior therapies you can have. So if you've had multiple therapies, that's out. And so, and sometimes it's a specific alteration, or specific as in the slide for RET, you could look at, you want to go back to your slide for RET where you showed the four trials. And that is also a problem this way, is, you know, the ones that are that were done before. So you can see here the test that was done, and this happens over time. Some of them were by FISH or NGS or PCR or by FISH or by NGS. And so some of those are required that way, some of them are not. And so your test may have been done by FISH, and this requires NGS testing. So there's so many variables in a clinical trial that it's best to get a hold of the site. And so I think talking with your treating physician, having them connect with the trial, if they're not able to do that or not familiar, you're connecting with the trial. But just reading what's online is probably not enough to know. You shouldn't be making those decisions on your own.
Mm-hmm.
And I know sometimes you feel like you're out there on your own, but with those connections on the website, you should at least be able to get some information and potentially a consultation with the treating physician who's running the trial, if that's a reasonable thing to do, to help assess if that's the right thing for you.
Thank you.
And sometimes these trials actually also, realizing that these are like rare events, the trials sometimes pay for transportation, like, you know, like accommodation if you have to travel to enroll in the trial. So that's something to always inquire.
I know that sometimes people have to go across the country to the rare trial.
Could you speak a little bit, I don't know if you can or not, but the difference between the Blueprint trial and the Loxo trial, is it the type of drug?
Right, it's a different drug. As I said earlier, you know, we don't know much about these drugs. Nothing's been, you know, publicly published or presented at any meeting. So it's hard to compare one trial and one drug to the other. We just have to wait for the data and find out. But however, these appear to be very potent. These are different compared to the other drugs.
Mm-hmm.
These are next generation RET specific inhibitors. However, whether one is better than the other, we don't quite know yet.
Okay. And we may not know that for a long time. Yeah. And I think that's when we get these very potent inhibitors, and again, ALK is a very good example, we get these very potent inhibitors that are all very good drugs. And to say which one is better, really impossible.
Because doesn't it depends on so many things.
At this point, yes. And they're all really good drugs for ALK, and they're very specifically targeted. They all work very well in the brain. They've all got very good properties, and that is there's subtleties between what resistance mechanisms and things like that.
structure of the drug could make the mechanisms of resistance different, as we are seeing in the ALK patients. So the degree of resistance to every drug is different, and the types of mutations they acquire might be different. And you know, the challenges, especially, it could be even more of a challenge for RET because it's more rare compared to ALK. So trying to understand the mechanism of resistance is going to be extremely challenging.
But you, if there are two drugs, you may be able to sequence them and get more options,
right?
So, but, I mean, even though there are many drugs that do similar things, we're happy having more options.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I tell people all the time, if you're going to have lung cancer, now's a really good time to have it. They're so just in the time. So I was diagnosed almost seven years ago. I mean, it's been amazing, the progress that we've made.
And what people told you then versus what they can tell you now.
Right. Absolutely.
On the topic of immunotherapy drugs, so I know there's some that are approved second line, but then there's also immunotherapy trials with combinations. Do you guys have a comment on the combinations versus the ones that are just approved second line? Or?
So the ones that are approved are all PD-1 or PD-L1 inhibitors.
Mm-hmm.
And even though we look at PD-L1, I talked about it briefly this morning, we look at PD-L1 as a marker, it is imperfect, and it doesn't, it's not like a mutation, where if it's not there, these drugs don't work, and if it's there, the drugs have a very high likelihood of working. Even in our first-line trial where pembrolizumab is given, the response rate, if you have high PD-L1, is around 50%.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a, you know, that's left a chance. You know, better than chemotherapy, but it's the chance that it will shrink your tumor is about 50-50. And that's for people who are supposedly the highest to respond to that. So we don't have a great biomarker to say who is and isn't going to respond. So these drugs in a small subset of patients are looking almost like they can maybe cure somebody. And again, we hesitate to use that word in lung cancer, especially with metastatic disease. But it looks as if there are people who have been on the drug for 2 years, came off, and are now about 5 years out, and they're alive without necessarily evidence of cancer. So that's, but it's a small, small percentage, and we don't know how to find who those are ahead of time. So these drugs are really good for some people. Because they're not good for a large number of people, we're looking to combinations and other ways to rationally give people the benefit of activating our immune system and killing the cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And so the immune combinations, they're so early right now, there's so many combinations. If you had a guess of which one was going to be the best, I'd go with you. You know, I mean, there's mm-hmm. nothing. One response doesn't mean everybody will respond, and we know that because of the PD-1 inhibitor. The CAR T cells also could be phenomenal. We're just at the infancy of that. So we don't have an answer, but there are too few people who have the spectacular benefit to think that that's the only answer.
And to add to that, I think, of course, I have a little bit of bias being in an academic center, but whenever you have an opportunity to participate in a clinical trial, I think, if someone's fit and they have access to a clinical trial and they go to a large academic center, should always consider clinical trial options.
I think people often wait because of the misconception. Those of us with lung cancer already know that there's a stigma attached to that, so we know what that feels like. I think there's also a stigma attached to clinical trials, and I think people want to wait until almost they're too sick to qualify sometimes, because they have this thought that it's the last chance thing that I'm doing. And that's the conversation that my doctor had with me, was you're in good shape, you're healthy, you have this thing, maybe now's the time to give this a shot. So I think there needs to be more. I think there needs to be more conversations about that.
Right, you're absolutely right. I think there's so much misunderstanding about clinical trials. The different types of clinical trials for patients who have already had all the standard treatments, then the trials that might be an option for you are
think Alice talked about it in her talk, where clinical trials have changed dramatically. There was a time when we did phase one trials and you were really just hoping not to make people too sick. Mm-hmm. And so I think there's still a perception out there, phase one clinical trial, I do that when there's absolutely nothing left. And the examples are when we had, before we knew what EGFR was, we were giving people the drugs Iressa and Tarceva. And patients were on oxygen, they were told, you know, you don't have much time left, it's either this trial or hospice. And they went on these drugs, and they lived. They came off of oxygen, they went on trips. Mm-hmm. I remember when Roy Herbst described his first patient, and like went on a cruise, and like, it was, they're miracles. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't last forever, but it, in itself, it was miraculous. And so, not all phase one trials have that, but as we look at rational targets, it's more likely to be like that. And so it's not that a phase one trial is just for the very end, especially when you have a specific mutation. The phase one trials can be very rational, middle of the road, or sometimes first line therapies. But I think the way we do clinical trials and what we know ahead of time make going into clinical trials less of an unknown. And we still have phase one trials where it's first in human, we really don't know what the side effects and we don't know what it's going to do. Those trials still occur, but there are many, many trials where we have preclinical data and we go in with a lot of knowledge.
And to add to that, I think one of the guiding principles of clinical trials and clinical research in general is to do better than what's existing standard. So your doctor will never offer you a trial that he would believe would be less than what he would otherwise offer. So it's always going to be testing your standard treatment with something else or without something. But it's not going to be inferior to your current standard treatment. So if somebody's recommending a clinical trial where you're getting a drug, you can be rest assured that that is at least comparable to what you would otherwise be getting.
And the IRB doesn't let those trials generally go through. Mm-hmm. You have to have some equipoise that one may or may not be better than the other. If you know that one is better, it's hard to offer a patient that specifically.
I've also been heartened to find that I sit on the respiratory committee for the Alliance of Clinical Trials in Oncology. They are taking patient advocates seriously when we say, you can't make these trials so hard that nobody can join them. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've sat on that committee for 5 years. I've seen progress in that they are lessening sort of. I know we all understand there have to be rules and, you know, lines in the sand and all that, but they are doing much better with that. They're listening to patients, and I think I'm very heartened to see that.
And that's a very good point, and especially for phase one trials, we always struggle with, sometimes the clinical trials, you have all these checkboxes you need to meet before you actually get the drug. And there's a reason why they're in place, but at the mm-hmm. same time, you know, some of them are unrealistic, and especially for patients with lung cancer, sometimes they have some issues, and you know, we believe a drug is very much of a good option for that patient, and they can go on a trial because of
So when you were on Alinta, mm-hmm. What did you find helped the most with your exhaustion and if you had stomach nausea issues?
So I was lucky, I did not ever have stomach issues. I did have fatigue. I found that even if I felt terrible, if I would take a walk, I felt better. Mm-hmm. If I stayed active, I felt better. There was never a day that I wanted to go take a walk, mm-hmm. but I did it because it was better for me. I did some alternative therapy, acupuncture and healing touch, mm-hmm. and that helped me. Mm-hmm. And I think I think all the doctors would probably say that falls into the, it may not help. I mean, right, but it's not going to hurt you, so mm-hmm. those sorts of things were very helpful to me. So, you see, I also had like my hair thinned out, and that was lucky. But I was actually happier when I was bald.
Yeah.
And I was just thin, you know.
He's got a full head of hair, just so you gotta fix the stomach.
Yeah. Yeah, that's tough. So I think we've answered all the questions, and do you guys have anything else to add or any more questions at all?
I want to finish with just saying again that these panels change over time, and as we learn new mutations and new gene alterations, sometimes it is important to get retested, or if you've received multiple types of therapy, it's important to get retested, especially if you don't have an activating mutation. On the original assessment, if your doctor said you don't have any mutations, there's no specific therapy, that shouldn't be just the end-all be-all. And I will say sometimes people only get a handful of tests. Sometimes the initial biopsy wasn't sufficient, and people are told you're negative, when really there are subtleties to that answer being negative. And as we talked with liquid biopsies, again, there are now panels with liquid biopsies that you could do at least an early check and maybe not go through a tissue biopsy, that are pretty good in understanding what markers are out there. If the liquid biopsy is negative, though, it may be that there's not enough circulating tumor. So say, as you talk about your husband, if he's on Alimta and it has a good response, doing a liquid biopsy at this moment in time may not give much of an answer of anything. So you also have to know about the timing of it and the amount of tumor burden that's there. But testing on future time points, if you're told that everything is negative, may be important.
Or when something changes, if the chemo stops working.
Right.
Just to add to that, liquid biopsies are a great platform. It offers you an opportunity to have like all these testing, even when you don't have tissue. But what I'm realizing more and more is that patients who are newly diagnosed, sometimes they don't actually have what's considered the gold standard at this moment, like tissue-based testing. Sometimes they just have liquid biopsy results, and if it's negative, they don't retest.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really important to understand the difference. And even though there seems to be good concordance with the tissue, sometimes we see that mismatch, and for various reasons. And it could be because of the tumor burden, and every patient's tumor is very different, and the way the tumor DNA is shared is very different. So the sensitivity is variable. So if you have a negative liquid biopsy test, like Garland or whatever test it is, it's very important to make sure there's enough tissue to go back and confirm that.
So you talked about the fact that you could have no mutation, and then after several treatments or time, or that could change, and now you could have a mutation. Do you ever see it, like if you have a mutation in the beginning, that mutation is completely gone and now you have a different one?
You can have that too, yeah. So especially, an example is T790M. You gain the T790M, it can go away.
Mm-hmm.
It's because of tumor heterogeneity. And also, not all tests are equal. So in the blood and the tissue, there are different sensitivities. And so I live out on the West Coast where we have a large number of EGFR patients. And so many sites still do single gene testing. So they'll get PCR for EGFR, they'll get ALK and ROS1 by FISH. And I've had not a small number of patients who are negative for everything, and then we do an NGS test, which is more sensitive, and it comes back positive even for EGFR, the simple thing. So being negative is just not sufficient information
mm-hmm.
in today's day and age. And I have had plenty of people who are we test, and they're negative, negative, negative. But testing once and being negative is not quite enough information, And you could be negative but have negative for the activating mutation, but have TP53 or something like that. And that generally is telling you that you're getting enough to do testing. So having some mutations is different than being negative altogether.
Could you speak, just for those who may not know the difference, between FISH and the NGS testing?
So FISH is a a pathology test, and essentially it is a fluorescence in situ hybridization. So it is done almost like a protein test, which is done with a stain, and they look under the pathologist looks under the microscope. Oh yeah. Right. So essentially, a fish is actually looking for that gene, and it's actually tagged to an antibody, and there's a fluorescent label to that. And the pathologist looks at it under the microscope and looks at a number of copies of the gene. And so this is a way to say if the gene is in multiple copies or if there's a change in the location of the gene. It's called a break-apart probe. And the pathologist looking at it under the microscope can say if somebody has a RET fusion or like a copy number change, like for example, HER2 amplification in breast cancer is routinely tested by fish. That's a difference in the way the gene is actually, the testing is done. So with the comprehensive next-gen sequencing platform, you can actually have that information via a genomic sequencing approach rather than a pathologist looking at it under the microscope. Because when a pathologist is looking at it under the microscope, they have to look at each gene separately. So like for example, if somebody has ALK fusion, you do an ALK fusion fish, then you have to do a ROS fish, then a RET fish. And now, you know, very soon we'll have some NTRK. Probably next year we'll have an NTRK session. Yeah, I'm actually surprised we don't have an NTRK session this year. But maybe next year we'll have NTRK. So like there are a lot of new genes that are altered in lung cancer. So to the campus saying, you know, this field is just evolving. We'll have more and more targets. So doing these sequential testing with fish is very complicated. Right. So the NGS platform, you can get all the results with all the genes at the same time.
And then the immunohistochemistry is also a pathologist test, and that's looking for a protein that's expressed on the tissue. So PD-L1 is done by that. They have an ALK IHC that they can do, and generally it's a little less sensitive. And so if it's negative, you may need more testing. If it's positive, it generally sends you to find that the fish or the NGS would be positive. But it doesn't give you much information either. The IHC or the fish doesn't give you the partner. And so sometimes the fusion partner makes a difference. And so you can't get that. But from
Right. And also, like the other point that I want to make here is sometimes a fish will miss some of the rare fusions. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, this patient that we actually found a RET fusion. So we did an in-house RET fish and was negative. Mm-hmm. She was a never smoker, and we did this testing on the foundation, and we found this new novel fusion. And so obviously, like, the sensitivity for sequencing this approach is actually much more than like a routine fish. The advantage of fish and the IHC testing is that it's quick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as you know, like, you know, with these tests, it takes a long time to have the result.
Right.
And
half of that is just analysis, because they get so much data as they're sequencing, mm-hmm. that they have to have the whole analysis piece to come up with what's important. Whereas the fish is just positive or negative, you get back in a week or less. So.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It was nice to talk to
somebody. No, we appreciate it. I thought it was just going to be the three of us. Which
and you got very personalized attention.
Yes.
Yeah. Your husband diagnosed?
Last September, so we're going on a year. Mm-hmm. He's been doing pemetrexed and, carboplatin at first, and then pemetrexed the last 11 sessions. So we just did 11 on Thursday.
Tell him where you were on Tuesday.
I did tell, Dr.
Reckie.
Thank you. We were in MD Anderson doing a biopsy to see if he qualifies for the Adaptimmune trial.
Oh, wow. What was the biopsy for?
The lung tissue.
Or
the
original lung mass.
Yeah, the original lung mass, yes, but he's had biopsied 5 times now.
So. They
and the shoulder and the back and a little bit of the scapula, but it got a lot of the lung. So there is a lot of...
And that's his only active tumor?
No, he has small ones in the left, a little one on his L4, pleural effusion, lymph nodes.
No liver, no brain.
No, and we're hoping no hip, which we're going to look at in a couple weeks with Dr. Pinnell. We're with Dr. Pinnell here. So.
Are you live local?
We live local. We're just a half hour away in Sugar Falls. So.
Oh, yeah. That's awesome.
Fortunate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And has he been able to work, or is he?
Well, he's a stay-at-home dad, so the definition of working is different. So thankfully, his parents live in North Carolina, but they've been with us more often than not. And my parents just left this morning. We have a babysitter who's staying with them today, so he does what he can. But
he's here with you today?
No, he is not. He's resting since the biopsy and the chemo this week. He's pretty much down for the count, but I do think he needs to walk today, which he reminded me of, so I'm going to do that when I get home. But Carrie lost her mom to lung cancer a year ago.
Yeah, so she had EGFR mutation positive non-small cell lung cancer. When she was diagnosed, she was stage 4, but it was just disseminated metastases, and she had liver, she had 4 vertebral fractures, she had 2 asymptomatic, 2 or 3 millimeter CNS mets.
Never smoker.
Worked full time. We just take her to Disney World 6 weeks before. I mean, she was as healthy as a horn. And so I found her oncologist in New Orleans. That's where we're from. And I picked him out because, of course, I work for Bristol Myers Squibb. Actually, I'm on the nivolumab brand.
Okay.
So I want to keep that separate. That's right. But I do have a lot of insider knowledge.
So you live in Ohio, or you live?
I live here in Cleveland, but I was born and raised in New Orleans, and that's where my mother lived. And so she still has stayed in New Orleans, even though I moved away. But so I found her oncologist, Roz Ramirez. I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but anyway, it's not a comprehensive cancer center. But I couldn't convince her, even though I live in Cleveland.
No, sometimes you convince her. You're like, this is my home.
Oh, absolutely.
My brother had testicular cancer in Chicago, and I couldn't convince him to come.
Oh, really?
Really? He was going to come to the cancer center?
I mean, it was just, you know, he was working, and he was too much of a hassle.
Absolutely.
You know, so, I mean, we made sure he got the right care, but.
Right. I could text 5 oncologists at the clinic, Mom, come on up. I'll write the red carpet out.
There's no mindset.
Oh, no. She worked full time. She said, no, I'll go right here at my institution. I'm happy.
Did she do well for a while?
Well, what happened was, you know, and we're talking about these amazing responses. So she had Tarceva Avastin based on the Japanese trial, the data that's good, you know, Europe now, but an FDA approval. But her oncologist was able to do a peer-to-peer review, and insurance paid for it. So she had a great initial response. I mean, she had a near complete response, so we were thrilled. He was thrilled. But then within 3 months of that initial response that was seen, she had progression. So it was very quick.
That was before Tagrisso.
Very quick. Well, Tagrisso had just got FDA approved, and so the T790M mutation was detected. She did have it.
And she was
but it was just so quick. I mean, the progression was so fast. So she went from, okay, you have progression, we're going to keep her on Tarceva, and then 4 weeks later, when it was time to then begin Tagrisso, she already had new onset, profound neurological, symptomatic neurological changes with multiple new brain lesions. So it's just so fast.
Did she never do Tagrisso then?
She started it, believe it or not. We were in the emergency room with her trying to rule out meningitis because her onset was so quick with the neurological changes. And we literally, her oncologist, we went over to the cancer center, got the prescription of Tagrisso, came back to the ED, and started her Tagrisso. She made it for 5 weeks, and she succumbed. So she never had time, I think, to kind of get in front of the brain progression.
Did she have a biopsy with progression?
No, it was a liquid biopsy. Let's see, she had the liquid biopsy with Gardens.
Mm-hmm. So the problem with EGFR mutations, especially in somebody who's like so rapidly progressing, you always worry about this transformation, you know, to small cell.
It could have just been happening at the time when the trigger.
When it's that rapid, it usually it's something else.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you think it's going to transform as well?
Right.
Interesting.
Yeah. It's not common, but when you see that rapid progression, you always worry about it.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting, it doesn't lose the EGFR mutation. So I had this guy who's totally stable, doing great, and then all of a sudden this little nodule on his right lung was like 5 centimeters in like a 3-month period. And he felt fine because he couldn't feel it. And then like, okay, well, this is there. And in the back of your mind, you're thinking this must be small cell because what else could it be? Though we do a PET and we do a biopsy, by the time we get all that back, there were lymph nodes, there were liver mets, it was, because that's what small cell does. Responds well to chemo. And actually, we've kept him on Tarceva with the chemo for the small cell because he has brain mets that are seeming to respond, and the brain may be different than what's in the lung. And so it becomes, again, it starts to get very complicated.
And
you can have multiple tumors. Especially when it's brain and body. But as the more treatments you have, you can even have different tumors in the body.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for sharing your story.
Yeah. So when I hear about the long duration, oh, we live so much more time. She's my mom or somebody. I'm not going to retire. I could be here in 10 years. I'd be here 5 months. Who knows? We said, okay, Mom, whatever you wanted to do, whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, she had to go buy a new car.
I think one of the hard things is there's more uncertainty than ever because we have people who have remarkable responses and get to the next thing, and then we still don't have enough of that. Mm-hmm. And so really somebody says, and especially our non-smokers, especially our young people, literally the answer could be it's more than a year. I don't know if it's 5 years or 10 years or 3 years or I don't know, right? And they look, everybody's young and healthy, so you can't prepare tomorrow. But it's really, there's a lot more unknown versus before. It was get your affairs in order, and it's unlikely to be 2 years. And you could say that with some certainty, which is a terrible thing to hear, but it gives you some closure to work with.
Yeah.
You know? So you'd rather see your daughter graduate from high school. But there was probably a lot of ups and downs over the last 7 years. Because there's a lot of times where, is this the other shoe falling? Or
the conference is about to end.
Oh. Wow.
they got their fall.
You don't know whether to up your phone for another 2 years. Or, you just live with it. You just sort of, I'm a nurse practitioner. I didn't work for 5 years because I thought, well, I can't work because I have lung cancer and I can't be around sick people and blah, 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 all that. And then I was like, but if I sit here one more day, I'm going to kill myself by jumping off the roof, right? So I went back to work. Two weeks later, had a recurrence. But the guy that I work with knew my story, was willing to take that chance, and I'm fine. I've had this recurrence, so I'm working. So that's what made me happy. Mm-hmm. Some people want to quit and write a book and do whatever, and they need to do that. You just have to do what gets you through the day.
Whatever gives you meaning.
We got
a puppy, we went to France, and we got a Porsche.
That's in the first year.
Wow.
So
I
said to Chris, can't wait to see what happens next year.
So how many more money?
Who drives a Porsche?
We did.
We drove it today.
We were first.
Usually Chris.
That's awesome.
I drive the station wagon, that's fine.
Yeah, and what kind of puppy?
A Labradoodle. She's black with a little bit of white on her chest. Her name's Tabitha. She's my favorite of the three kids. No, I'm kidding. Fun
time.
She's the most behaved.
Chris's hip better get a little bit better because they're going golfing. My husband and Chris are going golfing
Wisconsin
in October.
Yeah, he's got some hip pain right now that we're going to do a screen before when we come in, or a scan when we come in the next couple of weeks.
I always find that it helps me to have a goal. My daughter just left for college, and she's doing this class where she's going to study the Holocaust for a year, and then she'll go and do this like 15-day thing, and we are going to go meet her then with my other daughter and do some stuff over there. And so that's one thing.
Where's the trip to?
They will go to Poland. They end up in Lithuania, they go to Germany, they're going to do all the sites. And then I think we're going to go to Slovenia and Croatia and Venice and Florence.
Slovenia, Venice.
Yeah, I know. So So what do you have as backup insurance?
About all your stress, because I would have so much stress having.
I'm a runner,
so all the time.
I run and try and have my time, and then I have a almost 9-year old who keeps me grounded, and it's better than it's been before. Mm-hmm. I would have to say some of it is harder in the sense that a decade ago I didn't get as connected to my patients. Mm-hmm. And now patients live long enough that you're actually connected, mm-hmm. and you have feelings, and that part is actually a little bit harder. Mm-hmm. But it makes you want, and then doing research for me is the other piece, because I sit here saying, this is not good enough. Mm-hmm. How do I make it better? I couldn't just tell patients the same things every day. So doing the research helps me know that I'm helping to move things forward, and I can say, and with since my career has started, I kind of started in the EGFR discovery era. It's only gotten better, mm-hmm. and so that is enough to help me keep going.
But how did you guys end up in lung cancer? Because there was a time when people would have been like,
EGFR was the beginning of it, and lung cancer became a different disease. Right. And I live on the West Coast where, you know, 30% or more of our mm-hmm. patients have EGFR, mm-hmm. so it became a very different disease than it was cancer medical school.
And for me, it was easy. First phase one trial with nivolumab, and I remember my second month as a fellow, yeah. and mm-hmm. I was with Mariusz Knoll, and I had no idea what this drug was, VX-1106, and he had a patient that he just literally was shouting in the clinic, he was like, look at this cancer, was like, you know, wow,
right.
I think at that moment I knew what I was going to do,
Welcome to Unified Conferencing.
My mom died.